Thank you all for coming to listen to me speak a little bit this morning. As Alex mentioned, my name is Charles Epting. I'm currently the USPCS outgoing YPLF fellow, as well as the historian for the USPCS. A little bit of background about myself. I've been collecting seriously for a couple of years now. When I found out about the program last year, it seemed like a very natural fit for me because I love writing. Over the course of the past year, I've published articles in the AP, First Days, U.S. Stamp News, American Stamp Dealer and Collector, and a couple of other publications. Much of my research and writing has been focused around sort of postal history of the 1930s. And in particular, trying to map Franklin Roosevelt's New Deal through postal items, through stamps and covers. So that's what I'm going to be talking about just a little bit today, some of the research I've done, and each of the subjects I'll cover very briefly. Either has been or could be expanded on into a full talk in and of itself, but I just want to give sort of a brief overview of what I've spent the past year doing. So very quickly, just a sort of table of contents, I'm going to first explain what the New Deal is. It doesn't make much sense if I talk about collecting it if the ins and outs of the New Deal aren't known. Then I'm going to talk about commemorative postage stamps issued in celebration or in honor of the New Deal. A couple of very brief Roosevelt patriotic covers that have a New Deal connection. Post office dedication covers from the 1930s are my largest area of collecting and my biggest area of writing. Civilian Conservation Corps, Works Progress Administration, and the NRA are some of the alphabet soup New Deal agencies that you may remember from high school history, and then promptly forgot what all the acronyms stood for. And then lastly, I'm going to talk about the New Deal cover, which sounds cryptic. But as you'll see at the end, it's my favorite piece of my collection and something that I think is very interesting. And then questions and comments. So to start off, this is the April 2015 issue of the AP. And on the cover is a post office dedication from 1934 from Washington, D.C. And this article I wrote really I'll talk more about post office dedications after. But I really wanted to study, everyone sees 1930s commemorative cachets in the dollar box all the time. And by narrowing in on one specific aspect of those commemoratives, I think it made for a very interesting article, and I got some great feedback about it as well. So I will discuss post office dedications more later, but just wanted to share the article I am most proud of. A little bit of background about the New Deal. During the 1932 campaign, President Roosevelt said, "I pledge a deal for the American people. This is more than a political campaign, it is a call to arms." And very quickly, people took those two words, New Deal. When Roosevelt initially said them, they didn't mean too much. You know, he didn't expect them to build such a fervor, but when people heard those words, New Deal, they really picked up on it, and that really became sort of this calling, this mission of the Roosevelt administration. And eventually, the words New Deal came to summarize all of his relief agencies during the 1930s. So as you can see on this button, Roosevelt for a New Deal. All of a sudden, the campaign became centered around this promise for a New Deal. And very quickly, within his first 100 days in office, he started implementing these relief programs. The Civilian Conservation Corps, the National Recovery Act, the Tennessee Valley Authority, Social Security, things that are still with us today even, were all different facets of Roosevelt's very widespread New Deal. So I'm going to talk about some of the ways that the New Deal has been depicted on U.S. postage stamps. This is the only New Deal stamp that was issued contemporaneously with the New Deal. I'm sure most of you have seen it. It's got 731, the NRA emergency postage stamp. Based on an NRA poster that was created as I don't want to use the word propaganda, but propaganda. And as you can see, this stamp very vocally advocates one of Franklin Roosevelt's relief programs. And I don't think people often think of stamps as being so overtly political. You know, for most of our history, the presidents have not issued stamps promoting their own agendas. And yet here's a stamp that was championed by Roosevelt and his cabinet with the sole purpose of trying to sell to the American people what Roosevelt was advocating. As you can see, the four figures in, represent labor, capital, agriculture, and women. On the original poster, that's actually a scholar on the far right, but Roosevelt was afraid that a stamp with four men on it would alienate the women's vote in future elections and alienate women's support of the NRA, so he changed that last figure to represent women. And you'll also notice that on the poster, that's actually Roosevelt himself with the men marching, and that figure was changed to capital on the actual postage stamp. And the actual wording from the Postal Services, or the Post Office Department, was that this stamp was issued to direct attention and arouse support of the nation to the National Recovery Act. Again, very sort of heavy-handed language in pushing a political agenda through a postage stamp. Ultimately, the NRA was declared unconstitutional at the beginning of 1935, and this postage stamp was very quickly withdrawn from circulation because it was advocating a program that the Supreme Court, that had been stacked by Republicans during the 20s, declared unconstitutional. So, fascinating story behind what is a very common and seemingly insignificant stamp. Here's a great first day cover I have of it. And what makes this really special to me, you see this first day cover a lot. It's not a rare first day cover. But what makes this cachet really special to me is that it's not a traditional posted, you know, first day cachet. Stores that abided by the National Recovery Act. So a little bit about the NRA, just very quick. It was sort of a price-fixing scheme to help try and create fair competition in the market. And stores that espoused the NRA and subscribed to Roosevelt's NRA were given a sticker to put in their window that said, NRA member, we do our part. And people were urged to only shop at stores that had the NRA sticker or only buy food products that had the NRA sticker on it. And it was the most progressive price-fixing law that had existed in the country until this time. Again, very controversial. What I love about this cachet, though, is somebody actually took one of the member stickers that would have been distributed to stores selling NRA authorized products, and they used that sticker as the cachet. And instead of it saying NRA member, they put a little piece of masking tape over it and stamped first day cover on it. So that right there is actually one of the stickers that would have been distributed to a store in 1935. It looks like a normal cachet at first glance, but I just love that it's actually a piece of the government-issued NRA propaganda. Very quickly as well, in the 1980s, for the 50th anniversary of these New Deal agencies, a number of commemorative stamps were issued. Unlike the NRA stamp, these weren't contemporaneous. These were not advocating New Deal agencies. Instead, it was just a look back at what was going on 50 years prior. In 1983, there was a Civilian Conservation Corps and Tennessee Valley Authority stamp. The next year, all kinds of miscellaneous New Deal programs. FDIC, that you see at every bank, was originally a New Deal agency. The Credit Union Act of 1934, National Archives, a lot of conservation work preserving wetlands. And then in 1935, there was the REA and the SSA stamps. Again, people don't realize that Social Security is something that's still debated in political circles today. Dates back to the New Deal and is one of the longest-lived legacies of the New Deal. So all these stamps are fun in that they commemorate the New Deal and sort of helps call attention to it 5 decades after the fact. And then lastly, during the Celebrate the Century series, in 1998, one of the 1930s stamps depicts various New Deal agencies, TVA, NRA, FDIC, WPA, CCC, and SEC. Again, that alphabet soup that every history teacher tries to get us to remember. And this is the last time that the New Deal has been commemorated on postage stamps. For the importance of the New Deal and for its long-lasting impacts on the country, I think there have been remarkably few postage stamps issued in commemoration of the program, but the ones that do exist are very attractive and I think very fun to collect, even though they're all so common. Couple of quick Roosevelt patriotic covers. Roosevelt patriotic covers are a field in and of themselves between inauguration covers, President's Day covers, birthday covers. people who supported Roosevelt really supported Roosevelt. And they went out of their way to create a commemorative cachet or cancel for anything. And the ones I've collected here, you know, you can go down on the floor today and find hundreds of these. The ones I picked out were ones that specifically related to the New Deal. So, you know, it's not an inauguration cover. The one on the upper left is when Roosevelt inspected the Grand Coulee Dam, which was one of the biggest public works administration projects. Upper right, you can see Franklin Roosevelt visited a high school, and it's got one of the NRA hand stamps on it. And then the two on the bottom are commemorating the first anniversary of the inauguration and President's Day, and they're canceled in Roosevelt, Minnesota. And what's really fun about them is they both mention the New Deal by name, which I think makes them a fun sort of side collection to my typical New Deal collection. Next up are post office dedication covers. These are just a few. I have, at last count, about 80 different post offices from around the country. During the 1930s, the government thought it was more important than ever to build new post offices, not only so people could send more mail, but so that it would evoke this civic pride. If you're a community struggling, if you had, you know, 40% unemployment, a lot of people were having a hard time putting food on the table, if the government had enough pride in your city to build a new post office, that really helped give people a boost. That helped raise a lot of spirits, and it led to the construction of 1,100 post offices over the span of 8 years, a faster rate of new post office construction than ever before or than has ever been since. And of those 1,100, like I said, I've got about 80 different post offices from around the country with a number of different cachet designs commemorating their dedication. A lot of times you'll see the local postmaster would sign them, or the local mayor, or even Postmaster General Jim Farley, if he was attending the ceremony, he would autograph the covers a lot of times. So this is just a slew of them from around the country. A couple of my favorites. One from Rhinebeck, New York, which Roosevelt was from the Hudson River Valley, if you've ever been to Hyde Park. And there were a couple of post offices in the Hudson River Valley that Roosevelt wanted to actually design himself. He said to the supervising architect of the government, he said, no, I want to draw sketches, I want to help map them out. He designed them in a style that was Dutch Revival because of the Dutch heritage of the Hudson River Valley. And Rhinebeck, New York is one of these post offices that Roosevelt actually helped design and then actually went to the dedication of. I was there last year in the week leading up to Hartford Stamp Show, and for sale at the post office, they've still got a book of the post office murals published in 1940. They have the original stock from 1940 that has not been sold out yet. And I think they sell them for $4 a piece. So to be able to have a cover from the dedication, the book that was published for the dedication, and then to be able to go see the murals in the post office in person, like I said, right before Hartford, was it really just helped bring this cover full circle to me, for me, to have the cover where Roosevelt spoke. Really makes this one of my favorites, and I love when there's more of a story. A lot of these post offices have since been converted to other uses or have been torn down, unfortunately, and a lot of times there's not a great story there. This one, I think, is particularly fascinating. Next up is one from St. Louis, Missouri, signed by the local postmaster. It looks like 90% of the other covers I have. There's nothing in this cover that makes it particularly remarkable. Except what it came with was a book that was published for the dedication. And this book, it's in a gold metallic cover, spiral bound. And it's about 40 pages of pictures of this new post office. People don't realize how quickly postal technology was changing in the 1930s and 40s. And this book really wanted to highlight all the new technology that was being created, the new break rooms. There was even because this was such a prominent post office, there was a shooting range for the postal inspector to use. Inside of a post office, you had live guns, which just seems baffling to me today. But nevertheless, again, a typical cover, I think, made exponentially more interesting by ancillary material that came with it. Another great one that I actually purchased from Big Zay, sitting in the front row. This is the only time I've ever seen a postcard post office dedication cover. And what I love about it is the front of the postcard is the old Cincinnati. The old Cincinnati post office. And then the cachet on the back of the postcard is the same view of the new post office that was being dedicated. And whoever had the foresight to do this is my hero. Because you can see the then and the now of the post office in Cincinnati. It's also interesting that the cachet was applied over the postage stamps, which is the only time I've ever seen that in all of my collecting in this field. But again, just the old and the new post office, the great New Deal architecture and then the more ornate pre-New Deal architecture is just a lot of fun for me. And then my last post office dedication cover I'm going to share is from Spring Valley, New York. And as you can see, this was one of the rare post office dedications that was attended by the Postmaster General. And he autographed it in his characteristic green marker. Nobody can figure it out, but for some, even in his autobiography, he doesn't know why, but he only signed in green ink, Jim Farley. He hated signing autographs in anything but green ink, whether it was a memorandum to the president or a souvenir for someone. He just had this thing for green markers, and he carried them with him everywhere. So that wraps up post office dedications. These next ones are going to go quick because there's so little material. One of my favorite New Deal agencies is the Civilian Conservation Corps, which was one of the more popular New Deal agencies, one of the ones that was least controversial amongst Republican opposition to Roosevelt. The CCC employed unmarried men between the age of 18 and 25. A lot of them were taken from cities and shipped out into the great wilderness of the West. And they were employed building national parks, state parks, flood control, forest firefighting, all kinds of things that needed to get done. This was the beginning of the conservation effort in a lot of ways, and certainly the beginning of the government-funded conservation efforts. So these CCC boys, young men who had families who were dependent on them, they received $30 a month, 25 of which was sent home to their parents, their siblings, cousins, even extended family would benefit from the money they received, and for all of their hard work, this was backbreaking manual labor, they only got to keep $5 of it, which may not seem like a lot, but the government was providing clothing, food, housing, so that $5 was to be spent on recreation or chewing gum or cigarettes. So these men, at a time when a lot of people were unemployed, the CCC boys did have a pretty good deal. They were covered for all their necessities. And they were providing, the reason it was so not controversial is because the service they were providing was deemed so important. And, you know, this, the very early days of car culture when people would drive to national parks on a road trip, a lot of the improvements were solely thanks to the CCC. 3 million men were employed in the 10 or so years it was active. It was ultimately defunded at the start of World War II. Because we didn't have an excess of able-bodied young men anymore because we needed so many of them for the war effort. There was no way to justify having them build picnic tables when we could be sending them overseas to help fight for this country. So one quick anecdote about the CCC. I don't think people realize just how much of the infrastructure they contributed is still here. David, you mentioned you've stayed at CCC campgrounds before. A lot of national parks today still benefit from the improvements of the CCC. And I was recently at Saguaro National Park in Arizona, and I was talking to a ranger there. And we were discussing the CCC built aqueducts to help with flood control and a couple of bridges they built in the ravines. And he said in the 1980s they decided to go in and build a brand new bridge because the CCC one was from the 30s. They didn't know if it was going to hold up. So they built this new bridge in one of the ravines. The bridge they built in the 80s washed out during the first rainstorm. And the one from the CCC is still there today. So the amount of manual labor that went into these and the skill of the construction of these projects, I don't think can be overstated. I don't think the legacy of the CCC is well known enough today or could possibly be overstated. Unfortunately, though, mail to and from CCC camps is exceedingly rare. I've tried to collect mail to CCC boys. Here's one to a first lieutenant in Vermont. The War Department and the Army were one of the multiple government agencies that helped run the CCC, which is why you have a first lieutenant. And I've also collected mail from CCC boys. This cover on the bottom is the only time I've ever seen a CCC corner card return address. So, very hard to come by. I was lucky enough to find two pieces of personal CCC correspondence yesterday on the show floor, and I would expect that is all I'll be able to find for the rest of the weekend. You see a lot of commercial covers, a lot of official governmental covers. These two are to Burley Brooks Incorporated, which was an optics company that manufactured camera lenses, so I have to assume that the CCC would have been ordering camera lenses or telescopic lenses or something for being out in the wilderness, but unfortunately there's no communication. But these governmental, these official War Department envelopes, penalty for private usage, these are a lot more common. I've seen maybe two dozen of these versus the eight or so personal CCC covers I've seen in my couple of years of looking. My favorite piece of CCC postal ephemera came out of the Riverside Ameristamp show. When I saw it, it looks like your typical, I say typical, but there's only maybe 10 of them that I know of. But it just says it's from a CCC boy in Saugus, California, to this girl, Marjorie Velt, in Los Angeles. But when I opened the envelope, there was a double-sided handwritten letter. And I started doing research on Vernon and Marjorie. And based on what was in the letter and other research I did, this is actually a note. It's his first week at the CCC camp. He had just been shipped off. He just ended his senior year of high school. And he's writing to his high school sweetheart, still living back in Los Angeles. They're only about 40 miles away. He says he might see her one night if he can get off the camp. But it's really this heartbreaking tale about how he had to support his family, had to leave his girlfriend, and work for the government. And as far as I can tell, based on records, in a couple of sources, they actually got married after he left the CCC camp. So a great love letter from a CCC boy, unlike anything I've ever seen. And just a fun way of tracing the history of the CCC through my love of philately. Next government agency, very quickly, is the Works Progress Administration, part of the Second New Deal established in 1935, constructed thousands, if not tens of thousands, of roads, parks, schools, city halls, libraries, you name it. If it was a governmental building, WPA would have built it. And between 1935 and 1943, when the program was ultimately defunded by the government, spent over $13 billion and employed 8 million people. WPA was great because whereas the CCC was very limited in its scope, CCC was only unmarried men between 18 and 25. The WPA employed older men. It employed women, it employed married couples. The WPA was designed to be as wide-reaching as possible. And they would women would cook food for the poor or sew clothes for the poor. It employed artists, writers, historians, photographers, you name it. But even though it employed 8 million people, official correspondence to and from the WPA is remarkably rare. Here's one from the WPA headquarters in Pittsburgh to one of its employees, actually. This was a gentleman, an immigrant, who was employed by the WPA for a couple of years. And what's interesting about this is a lot of times they didn't think to actually mark down where the WPA offices were located or what they were actually doing. So the return address is great because it allowed me to actually look up the building where the WPA was located in Pittsburgh. This is where the regional headquarters was. And the only reason I was able to find that is because of the corner card. So it's just fun to see a picture of where this letter would have been coming from. Very similar cover is from the Salt Lake City Regional Post Office. This cover has a lot going on. It pays the 18-cent airmail rate. It's got a National Airmail Week cachet on the left-hand side. It's got a couple of return addresses, both the national headquarters in Washington and the regional office in Salt Lake City. And fortunately, this building where the WPA was located in Salt Lake City is still standing today. And next time I'm in Utah, I'm going to make a point of actually bringing this letter back to where it was sent from. Just to try and, like I did with the Rhinebeck post office cover, try and bring things full circle and just try and figure out. For me, it's always fun to trace these locations of the WPA. And this morning, I took a walk at 6:30 in the morning to find a WPA museum that was constructed in Grand Rapids. So for me, it's a love of the New Deal that just sort of intersects with my love of philately. And I love when a great piece like this really satisfies both hobbies for me. The last agency I'm going to talk about very briefly is the National Recovery Administration, which, as I said earlier, was price fixing to eliminate destructive competition. Again, very heavy-handed wording from the Roosevelt administration when it comes to the NRA. Technically voluntary, although if your business didn't subscribe to the NRA regulations, you were sort of ostracized, and that voluntary term is debatable. It's famous for its Blue Eagle logo. This is a hat that I bought for my girlfriend a couple months ago, and anything that was manufactured by a company that subscribed to the NRA would put the logo in there. You'll see picture frames with it, you'll see China with it, you'll see greeting cards with it, you'll see chewing gum with it. If you espouse the NRA philosophy, you really wanted to promote it because people would buy your product over a non-NRA product, because the government was saying only support products where you see the eagle. So it's fun just to have a hat with the original NRA logo inside of it. There's a number of, I'm sure all of you have seen commercial covers from 33, 34, 35 with the NRA Blue Eagle on them. There are countless variations of Cinderella's. There's pre-printed NRA logos. So I have one from the San Diego Chamber of Commerce where on their official letterhead, you've got the NRA Eagle. Rubber stamps were another very popular one where instead of printing it, they'd actually just hand stamp each one. Postage stamp style Cinderellas that actually have perforations. I have a couple of full sheets of NRA Cinderellas that are one of my favorite things in my collection. And then stickers, so Cinderellas that don't have the perforations but serve a similar purpose, so that if a lumber company or a manufacturing company wanted to prove to their clients that they were NRA authorized, they would just stick these on all their envelopes, and that makes these remarkably common to see today. Here's just a whole slew. There's the San Diego Chamber of Commerce one I mentioned. A whole slew of cut corners and cut Cinderellas of the NRA Blue Eagle. But this is a fun Cinderella that most people don't think of when it comes to NRA. These were Cinderellas issued for the Hobby Collectors Exhibition, New York City, 1934. And they look like a lot of other commemorative Cinderellas from the 30s. Things like this are a dime a dozen, and nobody's even really taking the time to catalog them because there's just so many. So I was looking at these online, and then I looked closer, and I noticed that in the bottom left corner of each one, there is actually a minuscule NRA eagle. And these things are maybe an inch and a half tall, so you think about how small that NRA eagle is. But because this exhibition was part of the NRA, they really wanted to advertise that to people, and it just shows how pervasive the NRA was, where you know, you couldn't pick up a magazine or a book or go to a movie in the 1930s without being blasted with this Blue Eagle logo. And it really was this very heavy-handed, ultimately unconstitutional law, but for a short time it became a part of popular culture, and that's why I enjoy collecting these Blue Eagles so much. So I'm going to end with my favorite piece in my collection. And I know, Alex, I've shown you this in person. I just call it the New Deal cover. I don't know what to call this thing. And I'll give you all a minute to look at it and then explain what little I've been able to deduce from it. Somebody, obviously, who is a big supporter of Roosevelt, a big supporter of the New Deal, decided to collect 10 different postmarks that spell out America Aid New Deal, NIRA, National Industrial Recovery Act, is what that's short for, means recovery, Franklin Delano Roosevelt. These postmarks were collected from August of 1935 through March of 1936. And what must have been done is they would have put this inside of a larger envelope, mailed it to the 10 various post offices, and said, can you cancel this in, after America, they'd send it to aid and say, can you cancel it to the right? And then put that inside of a larger envelope and ship it back, because there's no address on this thing. I've never seen anything like this. I know there are other covers that spell out sentences, and it's not rare for someone to have a cover that says, Babe or Ruth, or you spell it, trying to spell out Marilyn Monroe, famous names and things. But for someone to have gone through the trouble of collecting 10 different postmarks for a very, very pro-Roosevelt, pro-patriotic message, it's really remarkable to me. Only 4 of these 10 post offices are still operating today, which I think is really fun that 6 of them are now dead post offices. And of those 6, I believe 4 of them were actually casualties of the Great Depression. So this is a very pro-New Deal, pro-Roosevelt cover, yet the post offices they were getting postmarks from were dying off just years after this cover was created. The closest thing I've been able to find to this in all of my research is this cover on the bottom right, which is in the collection of the Smithsonian. It was created between 37 and 38 by James Farley as a personal gift to Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And Farley went through the trouble of spelling out Franklin Delano Roosevelt, New Deal president. It is not as ornate. It is not as, it's only 6 postmarks as opposed to 10. But the fact that it came after my New Deal cover by a year or two makes me wonder if this, I know nothing about who created my cover. But one thought I had was, if this was created by a prominent philatelist, could James Farley have seen it and been inspired to create his cover? Because a lot of the New Deal and the Franklin Delano Roosevelt, those post offices are the same on both covers. So I'm curious if maybe Farley came across this somehow and thought, hey, that would be a great gift for Franklin. But beyond that, I really know nothing about the New Deal cover. And I wish there was a letter stuck inside. I wish there was some sort of provenance. But on the other hand, I also love the mystery behind it. I kind of love that I know nothing about it. Because it's a fun story, and maybe someday I'll be able to trace its origin. But for now, it just remains my favorite piece, but also my most mysterious piece. So with that, if there's any questions or comments, I want to thank you all again for coming and listening to me. And hopefully this research on the New Deal and Philately takes me other places. Now that my fellowship is wrapping up, I hope that I can continue in a serious way to contribute to the hobby of philately, thanks to the great backing and the great work I've done as a YPLF fellow. So thank you all again for coming, and like I said, if there's any questions or comments, I'd be happy to take them.